You guys don't want to learn, do you? Okay, so jokes, then learning. Got it. Okay. Why don't cheetahs like to take baths? Why don't cheetahs like to take baths? Any takers? Because they don't want to be spotless. All right. Okay, this one I think was my, at the time, she was probably six. Okay. What is black and white, black and white, black and white, and green? She's got you, huh? Black and white, black and white, black and white, and green. Give up?
Yeah.
Three skunks eating a pickle. I mean, that makes sense to me. Okay. Oh, you guys are like, oh no, where's he going with this? My six-year-old at the time wrote it, so you can't criticize it too much. Okay, what kind of bird can lift heavy objects? What kind of bird can lift heavy objects? A crane. Nicely done. Okay, sweet. All right. So last week we talked about inflammation, right? We characterized acute inflammation. And then the question was asked in the back, you know, how does this differ between acute and chronic? So now we're going to get into chronic. We showed an example of a cobalt chromium hip implant. You guys remember that? And some of you, I know it resonated with, because in office hours, you guys kept saying, oh, this is crazy, that's crazy. And then I remembered that I had a hip implant. And so I pulled it out and sewed it back up. No, I'm just kidding. This was never inside of anybody. This is an older version. This is a titanium implant. It's not cobalt chromium. But the smooth surface, this comes off, so don't think you broke it. But if it, like, you know, starts rolling and bouncing down the aisle, somebody grab it, reattach it for me, okay? But what I want you to notice is the different shapes of the metal. This is titanium. There's a segment here that actually is sort of an open weave, and that's for osteointegration. That's for bone to integrate and really kind of secure or stabilize the implant. There's a spot right here that looks like where you would hit a hammer to lay the implant. That's exactly what it's for. It's the strike plate. And the acetabular head remodeled or refashioned is where those fittings were found on that cobalt chromium metal alloy. So it feel very similar. So you can see how smooth this surface is. I'm going to pass this around, and you know, again, if you twist it, this will come off, and you can just put it right back. Okay, so that's from last week. Also, hopefully, you guys got the arachidonic acid explanation, right? That was a very good question that one of your colleagues asked that had never been asked before, and so I was kind of surprised of the answer. But arachidonic acid comes from the new Latin derivative of a word for peanut oil. And that terminology for peanut oil has a 20 carbon chain to it, and arachidonic acid also has a 20 carbon chain. And so that's where that language was borrowed from. So that was the answer to your, rather relevant question, which I don't know all the answers, but I was able to find that one out. So there you have it. So the hip implant's going around. I'd like that back, okay, because I need it later in life. And now we're going to move into chronic inflammation. The biggest difference between acute and chronic inflammation is time. So we only have a couple of slides to finish this out. And you can see acute on the left, and you can see chronic on the right. And so the stages of acute that we've walked through are being broadcasted on this graph. And this graph is showing days after wounding, and this is a log scale, so you can see that the division between 0.3 days, or a third of a day, to a day is not the same amount of time, but it's the same amount of space on the graph from 1 to 3, or 3 to 10, 10 to, right, 100 to 300, and so on. So this is a logarithmic scale, so this is not linear, but it's trying to allow you to appreciate that there's three main phases. There's an inflammatory phase, there's a cell proliferation phase, and then there's this phase of matrix modeling. So three distinct phases. That inflammatory phase, we say, is a critical component of normal wound healing. And so if you don't have inflammation, you prevent wound healing from taking place. But it's a fine balance. You don't want to have inflammation that's elevated and stays elevated, because then it becomes pathological. So the reason that inflammation is important in the early phase is it because it stimulates a lot of the recruitment of the cells that help with remodeling. And that's what we're going to talk about in the next lecture, is the remodeling, or the tissue repair, or the tissue regeneration. So if you don't recruit the cells to the area, these first inflammatory cells, the first cells on the scene are neutrophils. They're what we call the first responders. They're followed very closely in time, a day or 2 days later, by macrophages, the activated macrophages. So the first cells that show up are neutrophils, followed very closely in time by macrophages. And it's usually these macrophages that will stick around, right? Here's the macrophages here. These macrophages stick around, and they remain elevated in a chronic phase. You can see the macrophages is this dotted line, and they come up and they never actually drop. They actually come up and they stick around and stay elevated. And then we're going to talk today about these foreign body giant cells. These foreign body giant cells are a multinucleated cell that's the fusion of a number of macrophages. So when a macrophage that has phagocytic activity wants to engulf a foreign particle, if it's unable to do that successfully, it joins forces with a neighboring macrophage and creates a two nuclei or binuclei giant cell. And then the third one shows up, and then a fourth. And so this large giant cell, and that's why it's named that, is in response to a foreign object. So if you were to look at this hip implant after 10 or 20 years of implantation, you would see foreign body giant cells on the surface, that interface. That was what was contributing to the pitting of that cobalt chromium hip implant. Okay? And I'll show you some more examples of that as we move on throughout the lecture. But the second phase is where you've got cells proliferating and matrix deposition. The fibroblasts come in. The fibroblasts release large amounts of collagen as well as other extracellular matrix proteins. The point of that is to remodel the tissue that was damaged. And so you have cell infiltration, then you lay down new matrix, and then the cells live within that matrix and they start to remodel it. And as they remodel it, they increase the tensile strength. Some of the cells disappear, they're not needed anymore. The new blood vessels that were developed in granulation phase start to regress or go away, they're not needed as much. And you have on the outcome, after some period of time later, usually what we hear is it takes about a full year for a wound to completely remodel. A full year. And so in that year period of time, that tissue is very sensitive to the elements. So if you had a wound, or if you had surgery and there was a scar that was exposed, you probably had your surgeon or the PA or the nurse practitioner tell you, we really want you to, in a couple of months after this is all healed, we want you to go about putting sunscreen on it. Because this thing will not completely remodel until a year from now. And then it's very susceptible to sunburns. Okay? And if you get a fresh wound in the sun, there's a very red streak that shows up where that wound is. And that's because it's not completely remodeled. You can see this is 300 days, it's almost a full year, before it's completely remodeled, and it's going to stay approximately where it is from a scarring standpoint from that point forward. In contrast, with a chronic inflammation, we don't see anything dropping. We see these macrophages and the blood vessels. Neovascularization is a word that means new vasculature. So we see the vascularity does not drop, it actually maintains the level that it's at. You start creating these foreign body giant cells, the fibroblasts stay elevated and they make too much collagen that creates this fibrotic response. That's the scar. That's the scarring that takes place. And so later in the semesters, we start unfolding a lot of these specific diseases, like, for example, look at liver cirrhosis. In liver cirrhosis, we're going to see scarring of the liver. And that's because there's a chronic injury to the liver, usually in the form of alcohol, over a long period of time, and that toxin creates damage to hepatocytes, and there's a wound event at the level of the organ. And over a long period of time, as that remains elevated, you get this fibrotic response in the liver itself, and that's the scarring, that's the cirrhosis. And we'll see that in a lot of other examples as well, but that's just one that I'll use as sort of a foreshadow to what's coming. So questions broadly between acute and chronic inflammation. All the players are pretty much the same. The only one that's really different is foreign body giant cells. You don't see them in acute. Because the macrophages are able to do what they're supposed to do, they don't need to join forces with other macrophages and form a multinucleated foreign body giant cell, or FBGC, right? FBGC, foreign body giant cell. So, some characteristics of chronic inflammation. Hang on 1 second. Let me do this. Show up, this thing is like set up differently. It's like not letting me extend the display now. See, look, it won't let me, it says I don't have permission. Okay, that's fine. They're macrophages that fuse. Giant cell are macrophages that fuse. Okay, so some characteristics of chronic inflammation. So we'll just go to this directly. Usually I have my notes on the screen, so that's okay. We'll figure this out. So up top versus down low. So down low is an acute inflammatory response. And this is in the lung. And up top is a chronic inflammatory response. And so what are the differences? What are the big differences? Well, on the lower image, you can see that the purple nuclei, or the purple dots, these are mononuclear cells. These are neutrophils and some macrophages that have moved into the spaces. You see how this is the vasculature that lines, and this is an open alveolar space, and there's some inflammatory cells that are filling the space where it should be wide open. This should be white, and you can see that this one's got infiltrate, this one has a lot of infiltrate, this one has even more. But if you contrast it up here, this is very, very dense where the astrid is located. So you've got a dense collection of macrophages that are sitting around and remodeling the tissue. These arrows themselves are pointing to depositions of collagen or scarring in the lung that doesn't show up over here. You can see that all of this tissue in between these arrows is all remodeled collagen. Okay? And then you start seeing scarring themselves on, and this is the arrowhead itself, scarring itself as a result of these giant cells. These are the arrowheads. See these larger cells that are showing up? So chronic inflammation up top and acute inflammation down low. So you get this infiltration of these mononuclear cells, but they stick around. And they stick around and they start concentrating. And in some cases, they start fusing, forming these foreign body giant cells. Then you have this repair mechanism that's trying to be stimulated. And so you bring in new blood vessels, that's angiogenesis, to try to heal the tissue. But what ends up happening is you bring in more fibroblasts in the area, they release extra collagen, and that forms a scar, or what's known as fibrosis. Okay? So chronic inflammation up top, acute inflammation down low, at the level of the lung tissue. Now, if we look at our chronic inflammatory cells, we're going to segue a little bit to the lecture that's after the first exam. We start seeing that the leukocytes are the first responders, they're the first ones on the scene, just like I talked about. The monocytes that are being recruited through from the bloodstream get recruited out into the tissue. As soon as they do that, they become activated tissue macrophages. And these activated tissue macrophages, here's an example of an activated tissue macrophage. This guy has the ability to stimulate B and T cells. So here's our T cell right here. It's activated, it can release interleukins to recruit these T lymphocytes. These T lymphocytes then become activated and start making products like TNF-alpha and interferon gamma. These mediators of TNF-alpha stimulate inflammation. Interferon gamma recruits additional macrophages that then become activated and then have activity on T lymphocytes, and the cycle continues. Okay? Over on the cell of the activated macrophage, it can go down its own pathway, not involving the lymphocyte, to just stimulate inflammation all on its own by the release of TNF-alpha and interleukin-1. So these macrophages are kind of a key component if they stick around for a long period of time, because they can recruit other cells like B and T lymphocytes, which is our specific immune system, or they can just act on their own and start creating their own pathways of inflammation due to the interleukin family and the TNF-alpha family that they release all by themselves, okay? The eosinophils and the mast cells, they contribute to a secondary level. They contribute to a secondary level by degranulating and releasing some of the cytokines that are responsive towards macrophages. And they're gonna be sitting around in the area in a chronic inflammatory response. All right, so in these tissues, we see that we get a walling off that takes place. So this is a granuloma. This granuloma that shows up in these tissues is walled off, or there's a fibrous capsule that surrounds it, because the main problem is here, and you can kind of appreciate this outer rim where the body itself recruits these fibroblasts in this chronic inflammatory event, stimulates extra scarring, and it walls off this lesion or this problematic zone. This is kind of like what happens in tuberculosis when we looked at with caseous necrosis. And then what are these blue arrowheads? Or blue arrows, rather. What are they highlighting? Those are foreign body giant cells. This is a really nice example, because you kind of appreciate, like, right here, this right next to this blue arrow is a tiny little purple dot. You guys appreciate that one? Here's another one right here. Out on this outer rim, you can see macrophages, all of these purple dots, but this guy is really large with, I don't know, it looks like 20 to 30 nuclei. And that's a foreign body giant cell that is fused, because, and they're all circulating this granuloma because they're trying to get rid of it. They're trying to eliminate it from the body altogether. Okay? And as this problem or this process takes place, right, as this process takes place, these cells that circle the outer banks are epithelioid cells. They're epithelium in consistency because they're a fibrous capsule that's formed. Even though it's within a tissue and it's not at an epithelial surface, these epithelial cells help to contribute to the walling off of the fibrous capsule that forms around this granuloma. So another example that I want to show you, and I think this is the last slide from this segment, is when we look at biomedical implants. And so what's going around is this hip implant, and we've got a lot of other types of material implants in the biomaterials world that are not hard materials, they're soft materials. And this one is a polypropylene. Polypropylene is a very commonly used biomaterial. It's made into suture, it's made into surgical mesh. It's one of the most widely used sutures to close wounds or close surgical incisions. The meshes are used for like abdominal hernias, they're used for pelvic floor reconstruction, they're used in thoracic procedures to close tissue planes. And we were working, this is from the lab, we were working on a project where this is controlled polypropylene. This is a similar type of stain, hematoxylineosin, to the granuloma, right? But in our recipe, we get a little less of the pink background than what you saw in that textbook picture. And so the purple dots are the same as what was seen in the granuloma. So these purple dots are the nuclei that you see in the granuloma. And the purple dots here are the same nuclei around an implant after 2 weeks, in a subcutaneous environment. So we just put it underneath the skin. And this is a polypropylene piece of material. All the white space is polypropylene material. And what can you appreciate by all the red arrows? These are foreign body giant cells that are forming after 2 weeks, only 2 weeks, around a piece of polypropylene. This is the skin that was explanted, and that's kind of the underside of the skin, so you kind of see how red it was. It was widely inflamed, okay? And over here, we created a coating. And so grossly, you can see that there's less redness here than there is over here. And if you look histologically, this is a piece of material. We didn't eliminate the inflammatory response, but we sure did decrease it. In fact, there's a large component of the area that is devoid of inflammatory cells altogether, right? From about right here to right here. So not half, but there's a region right here to here that's also devoid. So maybe it's almost half, or maybe it's about 40%. Whereas up here, we're seeing a lot of these materials are just lighting up like crazy all the way around the material. And that was a coating that we put on to try to minimize the inflammatory reaction as it was being seen as being foreign. And so what we did is we treated it with, this is an HECM, this is a human extracellular matrix. So we coated it with an extracellular matrix that was more favorable to that implant location in the skin, and the tissue took in a lot better way. Okay, so this is an example. If you pull out a pacemaker, you pull out a catheter that's a long-term dwelling catheter, you remove a vascular graft or a stent graft after a period of time, you're gonna see a tissue response, some reaction towards the material, and this is an indication that there's a chronic inflammatory response towards that material. Okay. So that's where we're gonna stop. There's a whole slew of additional slides at the end here, and those are just extra material. Some of you are very interested in that space of biomedical implants. Some of you can care less. Okay, so this is optional from that point forward. I won't ask questions on the extra material on the test. I'll ask questions all the way up to here. So you're gonna get a biomedical implant question. You're either gonna get something like that, or you're gonna get something maybe about the hip implant, but you won't get anything on the next ensuing slides. Does that make sense? There's a question. Yeah, the question is that reaction, when we say that reaction, we're talking about the left side of the screen, right? We see this is a much more aggressive inflammatory response than over here. The polypropylene is seen by the body as being foreign. And so the body is trying to get rid of it. And when it sends a phagocytic cell to the area, right, if you implant it, there's gonna be inflammation. But if you implant it and the material is biofriendly, that inflammatory response is gonna come up and come down. It's gonna be acute. If you implant it and the bio response is not friendly, then the implant causes inflammatory cells to come in the area, they stay elevated, and they never go away, and then those macrophages fuse and form foreign body giant cells. And you can try to minimize that, and that's what we did on the right side, is we coated it trying to mask the foreignness of the material. And we said if we put a human skin extracellular matrix covering over the foreign object, it's like a cloak. It's like a Harry Potter cloak. Maybe it won't see it. And it sees it less, for sure. It being the body. The body sees it less, and it doesn't harbor nearly as aggressive as a response. And so polymer coatings is a huge field of research. Actually, that's where I'm going next week, is this meeting is called Surfaces. And it's a biointerface meeting. It's all these medical device manufacturers that spend a lot of energy trying to figure out how to take a material, put on a cool, sexy coating, and make it perform better in the body. And the whole meeting is about the biointerface, or the surfaces that you can modify on medical devices. So that's what I'll be doing this week. Okay? Just so happens to be in San Diego, so it's not a bad location. Okay. Let's shift gears. Yeah. Throw my hip back? Yeah, I'll take my hip back. Can't dance without it.